patience. I wanna be a great one. I wanna be a great one. And when the spirit calls me, I wanna throw my hands up, ready to be saved, yeah. And when my day is done, I hope I die faded. When they take me way up, I hope I fly faded. What is life? What is love? What is time? What is choice? What is everything? Everything is nothing without you. What is life? What is love? I hope I am enough. What is everything? Everything is nothing without you.
So just before we join Mellissa Fung, Lauryn Oates, and Murwarid Ziayee to talk about what women are doing in Afghanistan and elsewhere and what Canadian women can do, please enjoy this wonderful song called Women of the World that was written and is sung by Jeanette Arsenault. Jeanette, thank you for donating this song. Bye-bye. See you in five.
Hey, hey, hey there, woman. Hey, hey, hey there, girl. The time has come, there's work to be done. Come on, you women of the world. Hey, hey, hey.
Arsenault, bringing us all together. Jeanette is from the Ottawa Valley, but of course, the women of the world are the ones that make the better things in life happen. So our thanks, Jeanette, for that. Hope you were singing along, and she'll join us again at the end. So on behalf of the Famous Five Foundation, thank you very much for joining us today, for taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us on a Famous Five Friday. A day when women have more power and see more opportunities. Joining us today are two women's groups. One, the BPW Canada, Business and Professional Women of Canada, who've been our partners for many, many years, and also members of IWF, the International Women's Forum. They are joining us because, like the Famous Five Foundation, they want to help Canadian women for women in Afghanistan with their mission, but particularly at this time, to bring the female Afghani refugees to Canada. So we'd like to start, as we are Canadians, acknowledging the Indigenous women of Canada, whose relatives have been looking after our land for tens of thousands of years. So instead of my saying a land acknowledgement, I would like you to just take a couple of moments and to develop your own. It's a step towards reconciliation. So please develop right now, in a few moments, your land acknowledgement. Thank you. Miigwech, again, an important step to reconciliation is for all of us to work together to build a better Canada, to build a better world. Today, like every virtual Pink Tea Famous Five Friday day, we're brought to you through the sponsorship, the generous sponsorship of Enbridge. And Enbridge always sends a spokesperson to introduce the panelists and to bring a message. And today they have chosen Miriam Riaji. Now Miriam Miriam started life in Afghanistan. She attended grade one, she graduated from grade one, but then a rocket landed in her backyard. And she was aware of other things that were used to intimidate girls to go to school. So her family then moved and lived in several neighboring countries. Finally, they came to Canada and settled in Kingston, Ontario. Miriam and her sisters attended Queen's University, and Miriam graduated with a Bachelor of Commerce. After spending some time in the finance industry in Toronto, she decided to join the energy industry and become a proud employee of Enbridge. And now she is the manager of operational excellence for Enbridge. So we're delighted to have Miriam with us today to introduce our astonishing panelists, champions, and to bring a brief message from Enbridge. Miriam, please proceed.
Thank you, Frances. It is an honor to be here today on behalf of Enbridge. As you may know, Enbridge is in the business of delivering the energy that fuels our lives, whether it's heating our homes, powering industries, or fueling our cars. Enbridge is an integral part of everyone's daily life. And there's nothing that matters more to us than safe, healthy, and sustainable communities. We have been a proud supporter of the Famous Five Foundation for nearly 20 years, and we passionately support the foundation's vision to champion the development and recognition of Canada's female leaders. We share this goal with Enbridge and continue to work on our commitment to diversity and inclusion as part of our environmental, social, and governance, otherwise known as ESG targets. In late 2020, Enbridge added inclusion as one of our core values, complementing our existing values of safety, integrity, and respect. We continue to increase female representation at senior levels, and today, 36% of our board of directors are women, and 31% of all leadership roles are held by women. We're proud of this, but we know we have further to go, which is why we're working to increase representation of women, underrepresented racial and ethnic groups, Indigenous peoples, veterans, and people with disabilities. As a Canadian Afghan, when I heard about today's virtual gathering, I knew I wanted to get involved. My family immigrated to Canada from Afghanistan 20 years ago for a better future. I'm grateful for my parents to have made the difficult decision to leave everything behind back then, just so me and my sisters would have the chance to go to school. Since mid-August, it has been heartbreaking to hear and see the situation in my home country. But somehow there is a glimpse of hope that life will get better for Afghans, especially with the help of organizations such as Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan. Momentarily, we will meet three international human rights leaders, and it is my pleasure to introduce these outstanding Canadians to you. Dr. Lauryn Oates is seeking peace in Afghanistan through education, and as a result, she's held in high esteem by many human rights organizations for her leadership and collaboration. Dr. Oates grew up in Vancouver and currently is based there, but the world is her office. As the executive director of Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan, Lauryn is determined to continue their nearly 20 years of teacher training, village libraries, literacy classes, schools, and much more. While Lauryn was earning her academic credentials here in Canada, Murwarid Ziayee was completing her BA in political science and law from Kabul University. Then, after working with the UN Assistance Mission in Afghanistan as the National Human Rights Officer, she worked closely with the Afghan Ministry of Women's Affairs and served the Afghan Office of the President before joining Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan as the country director. Now, living in Calgary, Murwarid goes to sleep in Canada and wakes up in Afghanistan as she oversees their programs, and with Lauryn works tirelessly to bring members of their staff to Canada who want to immigrate. Life in Canada for both Lauryn and Murwarid enables them and their children to be free to pursue their dreams and compels these mothers to do more for women and girls of Afghanistan. Leading the discussion today is a veteran journalist, best-selling author, filmmaker, and director of the feature documentary entitled Captive. Mellissa Fung travels the world producing original documentaries for international media outlets. Her best-selling first book, Under an Afghan Sky, chronicles her experience as a hostage after she was kidnapped and had to live in a cave while on assignment in Kabul in 2008 for the CBC. I have personally read the book, and it is a riveting read. All three of our VIP guests have earned prestigious awards, and no doubt more will follow, but more importantly, more freedoms, a better quality of life will follow for girls and women in Afghanistan, thanks to these human rights champions and their supporters. We're very grateful for their participation today and eager to hear more. Thank you, and over to you, Mellissa.
Thank you for that beautiful introduction. Thank you, Frances, for inviting me to be part of this discussion. Lauryn, Murwarid, we have known each other for quite a long time, but I want to start from the beginning and with you, Lauryn, and how you got interested in Afghanistan and how you got involved with Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan.
Well, at this point, it stretches well past half my life, and I guess I'll age myself in telling the story. But in 1996, the Taliban captured Kabul. They had been seizing territory around Afghanistan, but that's when they took the capital and became the government of the country. And I was a ninth grader here in Vancouver, and I was interested in justice, according, this is the version my mom has told me. And so she was sort of trying to divert my all of my excessive energy to something constructive. So I guess she kept telling me about different things happening locally and in the world. And one day she cut out this newspaper article from the Vancouver Sun describing the Taliban regime and the closed girls' schools and all of the rules imposed on women and girls. And I couldn't find Afghanistan on a map at that time in my life, but I could see a spade for a spade. I saw a great injustice occurring to girls exactly like me. And at that age, it didn't matter to me where they were in the world. I just saw that they were girls like me and that this was wrong. And so I went to work, and I suppose I didn't expect it to last this long, but A quarter of a century went by and here I am still at it in a slightly different way, but really, really just pursuing the exact same goals as I did in 1996 and doing this work under a Taliban regime once again, unexpectedly. So yeah, that was the start of it for me.
You actually tailored your education to be able to do this work. Can you talk a little bit about that? And also, I think, you know, you've told me about the first time you went to Afghanistan. And, you know, if you can bring us back all those years, that would be interesting for the audience to hear as well.
Yeah. So I went the first time not too long after the fall of the Taliban regime. It was 2003. And the country was in many ways jubilant and really hopeful, but also recovering from a really, really dark period. And you could see the impact of that in everything from the fact that at that time there were no banks. So I had to come with all the cash I'd need for the whole stay. There were no working phone lines. We used satellite phones and solar energy to connect because electricity wasn't reliable. So infrastructure was in a pretty bad state, but people were happy and hopeful. And at that point, it had been a few years that I had been sort of all Afghanistan all the time. And so when I stepped off the plane, it was like, you know, when you visit New York City or Paris for the first time and you've seen it in the movies and you feel like you know it and then you're actually there. It was like that for me. I stepped off and looked around and saw a place where I immediately felt at home. I immediately recognized what was around me and just felt comfortable. And I was 19 or 20, so I was still, I guess, coming of age, you could say. So I came of age with Afghanistan. Afghanistan was part of my formation as a person. And I always felt right at home there, and that continues to this day. And I got to meet women and hear from them. And one of the things they told me, and I was, you know, a hardcore human rights activist, and I came with this bag full of ideas about human rights education and human rights awareness. And the Afghan women I met told me, look, we know about human rights and we agree with you, we should have them. But if most of us can't read or write, then we are not going to be able to realize our rights. So we need literacy. So I said, oh, yeah, that kind of makes sense. So I eventually went back to school and I earned my doctorate in literacy education. And at the same time, Women for Women, which has always supported education programming, slowly pivoted to focusing exclusively on education to heed that call by Afghan women.
Murwarid, at the same time, you were growing up in Kabul and seeing all the changes around you. Can you tell us a little bit about what that was like, coming of age in a city? You know, Lauryn talks about her first time there, and I completely feel what she's saying, because my first visit too was very, you know, I felt like, and I've always felt very at home there every time I've gone, but that is your home. So can you tell us a bit about what it was like growing up there?
First of all, I'm so glad to hear that. I already heard that many times from Lauryn and from you also, Mellissa, that Afghanistan, Kabul, felt home for you. So it has been my home for all my life. And seeing the city, seeing the country, going through so much for all these years, and passing a life under rule of Taliban, which obviously was a life in prison. It wasn't better than death, but coming out of that life and seeing so much is happening so rapidly, like seeing international community coming to Afghanistan, and there's a new government in place, and everyone is so hopeful to change, and just pulling up your sleeves, and I am building this country. Everyone was up to that, like women. Okay, it's our time now. We rested for compulsory for 5 years, and this is a time to make something of ourselves, and also our country and our city. So you could see hope. You could see changes and happening in, like, you could see the changes every day. You couldn't, like, it wasn't the time to wait for a couple of months and years to see the changes, but it was happening so naturally. And with the aid coming through, with the policies and strategies developing by the help of our stakeholders from international community and also Afghan government. Experts came from all Afghans from outside the country who had the opportunity to go out, study, returning to country. So the life was changing, and we were really feeling that we are going through a right direction. We will have a very stable country, peaceful, a place for the growth of all population, including women and men. And social norm was changing. Gender equality became so prominent, and everyone was talking about that, like at ministry levels and departments levels. So seeing the country flourishing was a joy to see and live with it.
How did you get involved with Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan?
So I was working for several years for organizations working on at policy level. So that was very high level work with the president's office and also with the United Nations office, through them working with different ministries and developing the strategies and policies for gender equality, women inclusion, and women empowerment. At some point, I was feeling that I'm missing something. There is something missing in my work. And that was the connection with the community, that the human connection. I was so distanced from people that I wanted to work and help. So just this vacancy came across my desk for Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan as the country director, and I applied. I was a little bit hesitant because when you work for a really monster organization with thousands of employees and departments, and going from that to a small grassroots organization. But I didn't care that, because for me, this is the path, first of all, to reach to the community. Secondly, I read thoroughly the mission, vision, the history of the organization, the commitment of the leadership, and also I'm the victim of educational denial by Taliban for 5 years. So I was always thinking about women and girls whose right to education was denied by their parents, their partner, their brothers. So I was just thinking about them, how they would feel. It was compulsory by government, by a group of terrorists called government, Taliban. So putting these pieces like as a puzzle, like all these pieces came together and brought me to this organization that I stack for now for 11 years. And still I feel home, and that's why I'm still here. And I can't think of being apart from this organization.
I have been fortunate enough to see the both of you at work in Afghanistan. We spent a week together, don't know how many years ago it was. And so I've seen the work you do firsthand, but can you tell our audience what it is that, you know, what it is you do on the ground there and how you're making a difference?
That's the best part of my work, especially when I was at Afghanistan, and I'm missing that. And even since I am back, since I'm in Canada since 2018, every year I had the chance and opportunity to go back and work with the country office staff and also the program participants. So what we were delivering was providing different type of educational opportunities. It wasn't only for like educated level. It was for those who were in a life stage that had a job, had a career as a teacher. For those who never have been in a school, who just like education was a dream for them, literacy was a dream for them, reading and writing or holding a book in their hand was all impossible. So making all those possible, and I was enjoying to see that a woman in her 80 years and with shining eyes tells me that I'm so proud of reading the book for my children. I always had this dream and I never had the opportunity. So giving that opportunity for those who never had that and always dreamt for is something that I'm so proud of, being part of that program or seeing the impact on the ground, on people. I think it's a privilege because from here, it's hard to imagine how they feel, how they think, and how it changes their life. So through education, we could change so many lives.
Lauryn, how difficult was it to deliver some of those programs? What were some of the challenges that you faced as an NGO working in a place like Afghanistan, which, as we know, has been, you know, despite, you know, the last 20 years being relatively peaceful, always in conflict?
Yeah. First, let me just say about when we hired Murwarid, she said she was hesitant. You could see the hesitation all over her face when she walked into our office, you know, coming from the UN compound. We are not the UN. And she looked around and luckily she gave us a shot and has been with us ever since. But yeah, it's, you know, it's challenging, which means it's fun. We say all the time here that, you know, nothing is ever dull. Every day is different. There's always some problem that you never, ever imagined having to face and have to work your way through. So I like that kind of work. And I think I'd be completely dysfunctional in any other career. Because it's even when I've gone to, I once did a contract for an organization in Egypt and I felt bored there. There's not enough challenges here. It's too peaceful. So, you know, it's always interesting. And I think that, you know, you can get the work done if you abide by a few key principles. And one of those principles is to really know where you're working, to understand the place and to stick with it, because you will not learn about it right away. You can't go out and do one needs assessment and have everything you need to plan a program for that community. You have to stay in that community for years. And so what would often happen is we would deliver something like literacy classes in a place. And then the women would say, okay, this was great, but we need this. And then we would deliver that. And then they'd say, well, this worked well, but this part didn't work. And so we'd tweak. And over the years, we'd keep tweaking programs. And we just do that perpetually. We always come in with the understanding that something will need to be improved. And so our literacy program, for instance, which is called Afghanistan Lowali or Afghanistan Reads, we do it in a very, very specific way based on what we've learned over the years. So one of the things we found was the textbooks that are distributed to literacy students are very boring. They're dry and they're actually written for grade one students. So if you're a 45-year-old woman, there's nothing in there that's relevant to your life, right? It's like one apple plus two apples equals three apples. So we found firstly that they needed interesting reading material that was for their age level and was relevant to their lives. So we started merging literacy classes with libraries. So the library became the literacy class and the women go to their class with a library right there on site. And we turn the literacy teacher into a librarian. She actually takes a full training on, we call it basic librarianship and reading promotion. And so we did that. And then we saw that the literacy teachers did really well in the training. They learned everything. They scored high on the performance evaluations. But when we went to visit the literacy classes, they were not applying what they had learned in the training. So we said, okay, something's not working. The training isn't working. So we set up a coaching program where every literacy teacher gets coached on how to actually really bring those books, make them alive in the classroom, make them interesting. So doing like mother and child reading hour, having a reading contest or a book club or illustrating scenes from the book and putting them on the walls. So giving them those ideas and then walking them through how to do that because it was totally new for them. And that worked. So we then built up the coaching program. So we're just always kind of tweaking and changing things and testing things. And we go into it with that mindset. And we are responsive to the communities. We listen to them. And many of the places we work there because we were asked to come there. We were invited by the community. And then that gives us more acceptance. And the last thing I'd say is creativity. You just have to be creative. You have to be innovative and you have to be nimble, which is, you know, one of the reasons why I choose to work in a smaller organization, because you can be more flexible. You can get things done faster. And then you see the results of your work. And I can tell you, there's nothing in the world like watching a woman learn how to read for the first time. It is magic. It is just something to see. And for all the terrible things that have happened in Afghanistan over not just this recent period, but for really through generations, there is that. There are women and girls who learned how to read and write, and that's really something.
I was lucky enough to be at one of those literacy classes. You know, the women who were in that class had grown up when the Taliban were first in power, 96 to 2001, and they were learning to read for the first time. And it was magic. It was, you know, they were so happy and they wanted to, they wanted to read to me, right? A visiting journalist. So, you know, I can attest to that sort of the power of what you're doing. I want to take your mind back to August 15th. Lauryn, I think you and I messaged briefly that day. It was kind of shocking to see the Taliban roll into Kabul. And I think I told you I had just been there, you know, 3 weeks before it happened, and there was no clue. No, I mean, people were expecting it might, but that it wouldn't happen quite the way it did, so quickly and without a fight. And then overnight, girls were banned from going to school. Can you both talk about, you know, what your emotions were like that day watching that happen? Because I can imagine, well, I think Lauryn, I know that, you know, we were both in shock.
Yeah, shock is definitely the best adjective. It just, we had been concerned for months watching the way things were unfolding with the peace talks and also watching the not reaction, but the non-reaction from the international community and starting to see that there was no will and there was no motivation to prevent this, no matter what we said to them. And we did say it. We did ring the warning bells. And, you know, even with our own government here in Canada, days before Kabul fell, we were saying this could be very ugly. This could be very bloody. And we're going to all say that we wished we had done everything possible to prevent it. So we need to get creative. And maybe the US isn't on board, but we have to still find a way. We have to work with other partners. But it looked like it was almost accepted before it happened. But yeah, that said, it was still shocking the speed at which it happened. We were watching the district capitals fall one after another. And then suddenly people were saying they're outside Kabul. And the day they started saying that, Kabul fell and they were inside the presidential palace. And I have to admit, I just didn't see it coming that way at all. So we went into crisis mode overnight and all of us were working around the clock. We were getting inundated with calls for help from people who were really, really worried that they were going to be hunted down because of all kinds of reasons, because they worked for the previous government. They were, you know, had a relative in the army. They were a journalist. They were a women's rights activist. And an artist, a filmmaker, a musician, and also just people worried about, you know, a knock on the door where Taliban take their daughter to be married off, which is really a euphemism for sexual enslavement, because that was actually happening. They had real reason to fear that. So we were trying to keep up with the request for help. And then we had our own staff to worry about. And and just looking at all the progress made in the past 20 years and thinking about what was at stake. And, you know, personally too, and I guess selfishly, a thought that occurred to me that day is, you know, my kids are half Afghan and I wondered, will they ever see Afghanistan? Will they ever see their country? But, you know, we don't know what will come. And the fall of the Taliban last time happened as quickly as the fall of Kabul this time. It was unexpected and it was rather sudden. So things can change quickly, but you know, we're ready for whatever comes. If they're in power for a month or 5 years or two decades, we'll still be there with women in Afghanistan. We were before, so we've had some practice at that. So we'll be around, but it's, you know, it was a painful thing to watch. Yeah.
Murwarid, I can imagine how painful it was for you to watch. I mean, you left there 3 years ago, and to see that happen again, that had to be very hard.
I was very hurt. Actually, in fact, we had from a couple of weeks before, months before, we started scenario planning, obviously. And if you work in a conflict zone like Afghanistan and things are changing so rapidly, and you have to think about different scenarios. And you know that, Melissa, traveling from such country. I was telling to the team, I was trying to show them the picture. It's coming very soon without you realize it. It happened exactly the same way as it happened the first time when I was in Kabul in 1996. Overnight it happened. Like in the morning I went to university. I was a university student, and it was empty. The streets were empty, university, like only maybe 20% of students came to university, and everyone like telling me, go back, Taliban are very near. They are just in the doors of Kabul, and they are very violent. So I came back home, and by afternoon they were in Kabul. When this time it happened, one day before, I already had the sense the storm is coming. But one day before Taliban captured Kabul, I was completely prepared for this storm. And I remember the whole day I was crying. I wasn't myself. I was someone else. And it seemed like, you know what, at the moment that, I don't know, so many, I heard from some people in Afghanistan that they were in an incident of like bomb blast or a target attack or something, and they felt that they are dying. It's a moment that they will die. So what comes to your mind? It was for me exactly the same moment. I was feeling that I'm dying. And what should I worry about? About my family, about my daughters, about my home, about what I have achieved so far, about women who will be tortured. So what is that? And that moment was like the whole, like this 24 hours was the worst part of my life. You know the storm is coming. You know how the country will turn to what life, what destiny, what fate, and you can't do anything. It was just wait for your death. And it just came. For weeks, I had sleepless nights. I had days that couldn't stop my tears. Even working, I couldn't stop. Like I was working, but my tears were just, it was nonstop. So I'm so much hurt. I'm shocked how our partners let us to live that life again.
I want to go back. I'm going to go back to this in a little while because I think this is what we need to figure out now, how to help the women and the girls who remain there and how we can help people who are at risk come to Canada. But first, I think we have a couple questions from two Masters of Public Policy students at the University of Calgary. And the first question comes to us from Sukmani. So can we have that question, please?
Hi, I appreciate you answering this question. What are some current policies of Afghanistan regarding gender equality? And what are the barriers other than Taliban misogyny to implementing these policies? Thank you.
Either one of you want to take that one? I mean, I think we know what the answer is because the Taliban are in power.
Yeah, so I can start. We had achieved, as I said before, we had a lot of achievements in developing policies, gender equality, women empowerment, across the ministries, different departments. We had the Ministry of Women's Affairs established, Afghanistan Constitution as the base was It was the constitution that women were part of drafting the constitution and having the articles that safeguards their rights and protection of their dignity in the country. So the other law was elimination of violence against women. That was an achievement of the Afghan women in collaboration with Ministry of Women's Affairs and international partners. National Action Plan for Women in Afghanistan was another document that was developed in that time and implemented. And also the Afghan National Development Strategy with cross-cutting, with gender having a cross-cutting component. These were all in place. And although we had lots of issues and challenges in applying all those policies in a right way, but things were moving in the right direction. And we could see changes in terms of women's participation in different aspects of life, having girls and women back to school and universities, and also in some cases, gender, we call it positive discrimination for women and girls to have more access to education and university. A lot were happening, and now everything is reversed. Nothing is possible. Like all those policies, the constitution itself is put back at the shelf and is not applicable. And in fact, since Taliban are back in power, there were two kind of decrees that they issued. One, a couple of weeks before that, normally Taliban don't issue anything in writing. They say it's just verbal. And two documents that they issued, one was limiting women's access, women's participation in media. So that was one written document. The other written document, the decree that it came up this morning as I woke up, and I just saw that. And every day when I wake up, the first thing I see is the news. And I saw that this decree says about women's rights that according to Taliban. And what they say in that decree is about women's rights to marriage and inheritance. So these are the two things that they are focusing on. There is nothing on women's education, employment, political participation, freedom of movement, freedom of expression, nothing. It's all about getting married, at what age and the conditions. And these are the things that are in Islam. So they obviously, in writing, they will not go with against that. They are just copying the verses of Islam and Quran and put it in writing. And very limited to only marriage, family relations, and right to inheritance. So that's the only thing. And that scares me, because if this is only Taliban's version of vision of women's rights, and to make the international community satisfied that we are working towards women's rights, ensuring women's rights, and this is how they want to present to the international community, I'm afraid that they may convince some of their counterparts that they are moving to the right direction, and this is not the right direction.
No, it's not at all. We have a second question now from Lauryn at the University of Calgary. Different one.
As a future policymaker in immigration and refugee issues, in regards to the proposed feminist international assistance plan, in your opinion, what should a feminist approach include? Thank you for your leadership.
Okay, I was going to ask Lauryn to answer that, but oh. You disappeared for a while. Do you want to take that one, Lauryn, to Lauryn?
Sure. Canada has this much lauded feminist international foreign policy, the FIAP, as we call it around here. And in principle, this is an absolutely applaudable initiative and much needed one, and very responsive to the hard evidence we have from political scientists and international relations experts and people who study human development and economics that show this undeniable correlation between the status of women and a whole bunch of other things, everything from health measures and literacy rates, not only for women, but for men and women, so overall in a country, to the wealth, to something I find really interesting, which is the sort of state of peace of countries. So there's interesting work done by Dr. Valerie Hudson and her team at A&M Texas University that has found, looking at all kinds of indicators for states, that the strongest predictor of how peaceful a country is how well its women are treated. And you can easily see that. If you just look on a map, you look at the places where there's been wars for a long time, and often those are places where the status of women is really, really poor. So that seems obvious. So it's really not only for the human rights of women and to do good by women, it's actually good for everyone. It's good for countries economically, politically, to do better by women. And we're starting to see that acknowledged in policy. So I think that's important. I think it's responding to evidence. That said, I'm not sure that we're going to see this feminist international foreign policy at work in Afghanistan anymore. And some of the reasons for that are understandable. It's hard to do foreign assistance in a country that's governed by the Taliban, where both our government and taxpayers don't want to see Canadian taxpayer money going to the Taliban government. I understand that. I think it's undeniable that there is no country in the world right now that is a better match for a feminist international foreign policy than the one country where women have institutionalized discrimination facing them. The previous question was asking about, you know, policies of gender equality. What Afghanistan has is a policy of gender inequality. It has a systemic institutionalized policy that's intended to push women down precisely at the moment where almost every country in the world is going in the opposite direction, is trying to improve, is trying to do better. So that is really where this kind of policy is designed to be working. So our government has to find ways to make that happen that work around the limitations, that work around the fact that the Taliban is governing. They have to get creative and they have to get innovative, because you know, policies are wonderful in being aspirational. They're a way to put goals down on paper, but they have to actually be applied too, to be worth their salt. So we're going to have to really think about how to make this work in a place like Afghanistan, where it's needed most.
Frances is going to hop on back, join us back in a bit, but I just want to ask, what are you able to do on the ground there now? What sort of, you know, which part of your programming is still accessible for women and girls there? I mean, it's day 77 that girls have been out of school, at least high school girls, for most of the country.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that, because, you know, for me, it was just obvious that we would carry on working. But in those early days, people would say, well, is your organization doing anything? Are you able to keep working? So we realized, oh, we have to actually make that explicit. I mean, we have to work harder than we've ever had to work before, because our mandate being about women and girls' human rights and the right to education and making that a reality, I mean, it's never been more important than right now. So this is the most relevant time of all for our programs to keep going and our mandate to really be realized. So we are still working, but we have had to learn to work in new ways. And it's a bit of a mixed bag across our field. Three field programs, which are investing in basic education, the literacy program Murwarid talked about earlier, and technology for education. We have some programs like our technology for education program that is virtually uninterrupted, because people have always accessed it virtually. So they've continued doing that. And we've even seen an uptick in access. And then we have programs like the literacy classes where we had to pause because it just wasn't safe to run them. And we're redesigning them to work in this environment. And then everything in between, where we had activities that we've done for a long time, but we had to pivot how we did them. And the other thing that we had to take on in addition to that was emergency assistance. You know, we are more of a development organization. We're a human rights organization. We're not a humanitarian assistance organization. But the reality is that people in Afghanistan are on the verge of starvation. And so we've needed to respond to people's needs. So we started with the needs of the internally displaced. Because in the days leading up to the fall of Kabul, as other capitals were falling in provinces, people were fleeing there and coming to Kabul with just the clothes on their back. And there were, you know, moms with babies who needed formula and people needed food and all kinds of things. So our team organized a distribution of emergency items for families like that. And we'll continue responding to those emergency needs. And then the other thing that's happening that's new is the mass movement of people. People leaving Afghanistan, trying to leave Afghanistan, and they also have the same needs. They still need education. And the research shows us that the longer people's educations are interrupted, that's a huge destabilizing factor later on. And we saw that, you know, for every person before in Afghanistan who fled in the 80s or the 90s and managed to get an education when they were in a refugee camp or living somewhere temporarily, that was an asset when they came back to Afghanistan later, when political circumstances changed. And so refugees, internally displaced people, migrants need access to education. So we're going to bring our programs to them. So we'll be working outside of Afghanistan to respond to the needs of people on the move, people in precarious circumstances, and bring our same programs there.
Great. I think Frances is going to join us.
Yes, I always hate to break into these fabulous discussions, and what a lot of information we have received today. I'm getting a number of questions come through the chat room, but also on my office computer, people are sending issues too that they would like raised. And so I would like to remind everybody who's registered that following this pink tea in about 10-12 minutes, you're invited to another discussion where you can ask the questions directly to our program participants. We know for sure Mellissa's coming, but hopefully Lauryn or Murwarid will be able to join us for a while, because we do need to know more. The Famous Five Foundation has developed a series of four questions to learn from our wonderful champions as to how they handle difficult situations. And so I'm going to go into that and ask them to just answer with one or two words what the response would be to the statement. So the statement, first statement is, when I am confused, I, Lauryn, what do you do? One or two words.
I read.
You inform yourself. Excellent. Mellissa. Sorry, you're muted, Mellissa.
When I'm confused, I just take a break and think.
Thank you. And Murwarid, what do you do?
I talk to someone I trust.
Oh, three very good answers. When I'm sad, I, Lauryn?
I just let myself be sad. I think there's probably a good reason for it, and sometimes we need to be sad, so I just go with it.
Thank you. Mellissa?
I cry. There's been a lot of that last 4 months.
Yeah. Murwarid.
The same response, I cry.
Third question is, when I am scared, and this is something I know all of you feel on a daily basis, because the risk to you for doing the freedom fighting work that you're doing is immense. So in just one or two words, and I say thank you for that. One or two words, when I'm scared, I, Lauryn?
So I say this little mantra that I say to myself all the time. And sorry, it's more than one or two words. The world is big, life is short, and there is lots of work to do.
If it is to be, it's up to me, right? Another way of saying it. Mellissa, when I'm scared, I
don't get scared easily anymore.
Oh. Good for you. You know, when we asked this question of Beverly McLaughlin, the former Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of Canada, she said, I never get scared. It's the first time I've heard anybody say it. So it's nice to know that there are many others out there too, Mellissa. So thank you. Murwarid, when you're scared, what do you do?
When I'm scared, I fear, I face my fear.
You face your fear. Excellent. Excellent. Three wonderful, or what was this, nine wonderful answers that will help the rest of us sort through life. And the last question is, this is a Famous Five Foundation virtual pink tea. So if the famous five were alive today, they would dot, dot, dot. Lauryn, what would the famous five be doing?
I would like to think that they would see Afghan women in themselves and themselves in Afghan women.
Yes. Mellissa?
I would like to think that they are doing what we are doing right now, is trying to help the Afghan women who are trying to leave and who don't have the option of leaving.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And Murwarid?
I would see them standing alongside in solidarity with Afghan women and raising their voice, amplifying their voice. I would see.
That's right. Taking action.
Yes.
Doing something about it. Excellent answers and excellent suggestions for the rest of us to hear and build on as we face these typical situations. And it's now my pleasure to say thank you to these amazing three human rights champions. And we're at a tea party. We're at a pink tea party. It's not just frivolous. It's of course important when women gather and talk about their lives and learn from one another. But pink teas were the way that Canadian women gained suffrage 100 and some years ago. Because when the suffragists said or put up a notice saying, please come and we're going to talk about how to enfranchise the women of Canada and give them the right also to serve as elected officials, their meetings were disrupted. The opponents came in and they screamed and yelled and they knocked over the chairs. So finally the women decided, well, we have a tea for Mrs. Jones having a baby and we have a tea for Mrs. Smith when she leaves town or whatever. So let's organize a series of teas and we're going to discuss suffrage. So that's the basis on which we're here today, is to discuss important issues and to take actions. So I hope you've got your teacup or your glass or your mug or your container with you. Thank you, Lauryn. Our champions are all prepared to begin the toast. And I'd like to, of course, begin to express our gratitude for the incredible Dr. Lauryn Oates. This is a brilliant and courageous leader. You and your colleagues, Lauryn, have made a tremendous contribution to Afghanistan and to Canada. And we want you to know that we are in solidarity with you and we will do what we can to support you now and going forward. And so, colleagues, a toast to the incredibly brilliant and courageous Dr. Lauryn Oates. To Lauryn, thank you. And please know that following this program, we're going to start contacting our federal representatives. We're going to contact our premiers, our mayors, our professional organizations. What are the lawyers doing to bring Afghan lawyers into Canada? What are the plumbers doing? There's all kinds of way different groups, scouts groups, sports groups can help to bring Afghan refugees and say to the government, please process the applications that are properly prepared and submitted through the SIM program, and don't jump the queue. Please, please bring these Afghan women and their families to Canada. As you heard earlier, Murwarid has been the country director of Afghanistan for 7 years and oversaw the educating of thousands of teachers, the training of thousands of teachers, the educating of hundreds of thousands of Afghan students, and the building of the schools, the libraries. Extraordinary, absolutely extraordinary accomplishments. And again, Murwarid, you're continuing to work through this situation and work towards a more hopeful future. So a heartfelt toast of appreciation to Murwarid. To Murwarid. And an appreciation to the impact that this has on your wonderful husband and amazing daughters, Hasti and Hila. Thank you, Murwarid. Completing this important circle today is, of course, Mellissa Fung. This remarkable, well, highly regarded journalist, author, and leader in an organization called Journalists for Human Rights, Women's Rights or Human Rights. This organization and Mellissa have continued to support the journalists in Afghanistan or around Afghanistan to bring us the truth as to what is happening. Imagine the danger they are in. And Mellissa and the Journalists for Human Rights have also brought a number of journalists outside of Afghanistan to continue their work too. So our third toast is to freedom fighting Fung. To Mellissa, thank you very much for being a freedom fighter, Mellissa. Thank you. And of course, thank you, Mellissa, for doing the hosting job today. Very, very skillfully done. Our other role models, and we know role models are very important for others to learn how to be leaders, came from Enbridge, from Miriam, the manager of operational excellence there. And our thanks to Enbridge for being our presenting sponsor and longtime partner. Also to the two students of public policy. It's so exciting to see women starting to form public policy and then to be elected and to pass public policy and then to make sure that it's happening. So thanks also to Sukmani and to Lauryn with an E. So to Miriam, to Lauryn, and to Sukmani, thank you very much. And one more toast, if I may. Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan started 20 some years ago by two women from Calgary who were taking their degree in international development, Carolyn Reichert and Janice Eisenhower. Janice stayed on and was the executive director of Canadian Women for Women Afghanistan for the past 20 some years. And it is on her shoulders that so much has happened. And so I would like us to raise a toast to the incredible Janice Eisenhower. To Janice. So thank you very much, Lauryn, Murwarid, and Mellissa, and Enbridge, for your incredible virtual pink tea today. I'm now going to ask the talented crew at Encore to take you off the screen so you can relax while I just bring two pieces of news to our colleagues. And the first one is, please consider seriously as you celebrate your religious holidays at this time of the year and go to or enjoy year of the end parties, that the pen is mightier than the sword, that the voice counts too. And so as Murwarid and Lauryn and Mellissa encouraged us today to do, to contact the decision makers in Canada. We're very grateful that almost 4,000 people from Afghanistan have been brought to Canada, but it's so important that we bring the women who and the men who have helped Canadian organizations in Afghanistan and our military there, and that it be done in a much quicker manner, like it was done for the Syrians. So we are going to continue to speak out about this issue, and we encourage each and every one of you to answer the email that we're going to send you in just a little while with a synopsis of this information and the contact links. And as well, you can go to the website of Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan, and also the Famous Five Foundation's website to get that information and to take action. So this is your call to action. The pen is indeed mightier than the sword. The voice is even more important. Secondly, my thanks to all of you for attending our virtual pink tea, the last one of 2021. What a wonderful year. But 2022 is about to start, and we have a fantastic lineup for you. Season's tickets, passes are now available. And if you come, you will meet the Governor General of Canada. You will meet current and former premiers of Canada, female premiers of Canada. There have been 13, I believe. There are 13, two currently. You will also meet business leaders. You will meet Indigenous leaders, artists, and athletes all together. The price remains the same, $5.25, so no inflation. The date remains the same, famous Five Fridays, a day when women have more power and hopefully will use that power. And also when you see more opportunities, you will seize those opportunities. So now the last toast is to each and every one of us, because we are leaders too. Perhaps to one or two, probably to many, many people. And so in a strong, clear voice, please say together in a toast, I'm to me, I'm a leader too. Are you ready? To me, I'm a leader too. So again, thank you very much, Lauryn, Murwarid, Mellissa, and everyone who made today such a special day. You are welcome to continue to chat in the chat room, to answer poll questions, to send your gratitude to these three amazing women. Or just recently, you received in your inbox another email with a link to the next part, to the Après Pink Tea, where you can continue the conversation and ask directly your questions that we were not able to incorporate in the virtual Pink Tea. So again, thank you very much. Miigwech, merci. And we'll see you in 2022. Bye-bye.
Hey, hey, hey. To be done. Come on, you women of the world. Hey, hey, hey. Change.